All right, everyone. Thanks for checking in to this interview with FLW Tour Pro Kevin Finley. This is his rookie season on the FLW Tour. He's from Arizona. He's been fishing for a long time. If you're new to this channel, make sure to subscribe. And if this is on YouTube, make sure to hit the link or the bell for notifications so that way you get updates on new content. I've talked to Kevin on a couple different occasions over text message in person at the U.S. Open this past year. He's a wealth of knowledge when it comes to fishing, sponsorships, a lot of stuff. So I know you guys are going to get a lot of benefit out of this interview. So Kevin, I know that McMillan Fiberglass Stocks has been a really good partner for you. And, I think that's kind of helped you the last couple years for sure. So let's start off talking about a little bit of the sponsor stuff.
Yeah. And hey, thanks for having me, by the way. McMillan's been really great. Anybody who's, in the sport, we all understand how important partnerships can be because fishing's expensive. And so McMillan has been my banner sponsor last year and this year as well. So it's been really great, and he's a great partner, and obviously they've got great products, so it's real easy to be sponsored by those guys.
Right. Yeah, and I know that you did a lot of good stuff as well with the Wild West Bass Trail for McMillan. I know that they have the stand and stuff like that to weigh the fish in the tournament. I know that you organized some of that, and I think they got a commercial on Johnny Johnson's show, correct?
Yeah, they've got commercials running on Wild West shows and on Johnny Johnson coming up. And we ran commercials last year with Johnny Johnson. It's one of the things that I do with my sponsorships is I try to create an entire package for a sponsor and not just kind of take, but actually when the sponsorship begins to unfold, there's a multifaceted marketing approach for your sponsors, and that's what I try to do with my sponsors. So that's what I did with McMillan, and it's worked out really good.
Yeah, that's awesome. I know I get a lot of questions from people asking me, like, how did I get a sponsor, or how to get one, how to do this, how to do that, and what I try to make sure that people understand is it's about selling that company's product. It's not how they help you, it's how you help them. And then the benefit, whether it's product or whether it's money or a discount or whatever, is basically your payment for you helping to sell more of their stuff. And I think that's one of the things that a lot of people seem to miss. What are your thoughts?
No, I agree. And I think that, in our business, it's about, like, especially like when you have your truck and your boat wrapped and you're wearing the jersey and you've got all stuff and you're going up on stage on the FLW tour or on Wild West or BASS or MLF, whatever it is, you have a lot of face time, on TV and all different types of media, and people and all these organizations, they live stream now. Mm-hmm. And, we all watch it. And so it's about being able to get that recognition for your sponsors. They've got a lot of face time. Yeah, I mean, I drive down, I drive across the country because I fished everywhere from Florida. I'll be in New York later this year. And I have people honk at me because I've got McMillan all over my truck and boat. And I have, Bass Pro Shops and Mercury and, all my other sponsors as well. So, I think a lot of guys they'll miss that in the beginning, but it doesn't take long in the business to understand that you they've got to have some type of long term recognition out of it, and that's what fishermen can really do is put that name out there in front of everybody all the time.
Yeah, and one of the things that I've noticed just traveling around, and I don't have a wrap on my boat or anything like that, but the boats get a lot of attention. Just the mere fact that everyone, when you stop at the gas station or whatever, they're always commenting, or you run through fast food and they're, oh, what a nice boat, or that motor's huge, or what are those poles on the back? And you know that whenever they ask you that stuff, they're obviously looking at whatever logos you might have, especially if you have a wrap, because those are so eye-catching and all that, that I think that some of that mobile advertising doesn't get the credit that it probably deserves, because you're just a big billboard traveling across the country.
No, it is true. And I mean, how many times do you get asked about your power poles or your 10 foot? That's probably the number one. And it, brings people over, and then, you know, they see all the names on the boat and everything. Yeah, you're right. It is. It's a really good marketing tool.
For sure. Well, let's move on to the funner part, the fishing side. I mean, the business side of things is very important, but I think a lot of people are tuning in, you know, wanting to know a little bit more on the fishing side. But those are some things that I just know from talking to you that you're a wealth of knowledge when it comes to the business side of fishing. And, you know, I just wanted to tap into that a little bit. But getting onto the fishing, just start off and explain to everyone, you know, how you got into fishing, or, you know, what made you want to start fishing tournaments, and then what led you into fishing on the, you know, highest level that there is.
You know, it's weird. I lived in Chicago, you know, hardly the greatest place to be a bass fisherman, you know, and, but my old man, he took me up to Wisconsin one time to fish, some lakes up there. You know, they were generally a little cleaner and a little better fishing up there. And we went up there and I remember being excited about it for a long time before we went. Like, I was really excited. You know, a kid gets excited when you go fishing. And we got up there and we got blanked. You know, I didn't even get a bite, and I was sold. Like, that was it. I was like, this is what I want to do. This is it. You know, and I mean, how do you understand that you're going to do that for the rest of your life from the art of being skunked? I mean, I don't know how that happens, but that's what happened with me.
It happened to me on Sunday. So,
yeah. So we moved out to Arizona after that, and obviously Arizona's a great place to live for bass fishing. And so I started that, you know, at a pretty young age. I was probably 11 or 12 when I really started getting into it. And my old man would drop me off at the lake before work and in my little boat, and then he would come pick me up after work in my little boat and all summer long when I would be out of school. So that's how I got started.
That's awesome. Yeah, I have a similar story like that when I was a kid going fishing. It was trout fishing, you know, at Lake Jennings, which is a real small lake here in San Diego. And like, you can't even get up on plane. It's 5 mile an hour around the whole place. And we went trout fishing and we didn't even get a fish. And I just remember being all stoked, just hanging out with my dad, going to the lake fishing. And the fact we didn't even catch a fish, but like, eventually we got better and started catching fish, and it makes it more fun for sure. But it's just crazy that as a kid, just, I think it's just that quality time with whoever you were with is what gets you hooked, and just being outside and, you know, just hoping that you're going to catch something.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think there's just something about going in the outdoors, whether it be fishing or hunting or whatever. I think being able to hang out with your dad or the family and be able to do that, it is. There's something different about it. You know, it's not like hanging out playing video games. There's something different about it.
Right. No, I agree with you 100%. So what transitioned into fishing the tournament thing? And then I know you've fished the One Bass U.S. Open a bunch of times. You fished some Wild West. You fished some of the Costas. And then now you're, you know, fishing the FLW Tour, the highest level with FLW. And, you know, how did you make those transitions? What kind of pushed you to want to go and fish this tour?
Well, you know, it's different with me than it is with a lot of guys. I mean, some guys make those types of transitions because they're so incredibly successful. And that's not how it was with me. That's not why I made those transitions. I originally started fishing smaller tournaments in my teens, right around Phoenix. And I had some good success doing that. And then I actually met Gary Simft when I was young, and we started fishing a few things together, and then we had some good success together. And then I fished with Alex Dombrowski in the late 90s, early 2000s, and we had some really good success together in team tournaments. And we won a championship and won a boat and won some bunch of tournaments. And I fished with Gary too. And then I took a bunch of years off after that. I had for family and business reasons, I had to take a bunch of years off, and I didn't come back until 2014, 2015. I took 15 years off.
Wow.
And when I came back, yeah, that's a long time. And when I came back, one thing I didn't want to do is, you know, I've won tournaments at Lake Pleasant. I've won tournaments at Bartlett. I've won tournaments at Roosevelt. You know, I've done these different, but I just didn't feel like doing that anymore. And so I was like, you know, I'm going to fish new places. I'm going to go new places. I'm going to fish new things. And that's what I want to do. I was like, and if I can't do that, then I really don't want to do it. So that's what I did. I decided I was going to fish Wild West, and I was going to start fishing one bass stuff and fish the U.S. Open. And I really want to win the U.S. Open. I you know, last year I got ninth, but I want to win that tournament. And I think you do too, and everybody does. But I just got some goals in mind that are bigger than what I've done in the past before I took the time off. And so I fished two different Costa series. I fished the West, and then I fished the kind of back east a little bit, Texas, Oklahoma area. And I qualified through the West, so I didn't finish out my last tournament back east because I qualified to go to the championship through the West. And then I had tried to get in the FLW tour last year because I thought it'd be really great, you know, to be able to go and fish new water and new things. And it's not because I thought I was going to go in there and I'm going to knock Brian Thrift off his throne or something. That's not at all why I fished, you know, why I wanted to fish. I wanted to fish it because it was new, and who wouldn't want to jump on the opportunity of fishing the FLW tour? And then I got a call this year and they said, hey, I think we got a spot for you on the tour. And so I was like, I'll take it. So I've got the sponsorships to do it, and I've got the time to do it. And, you know, I have a business here in Phoenix. And so I did it, you know, and I have gotten my butt thoroughly kicked in the first three tournaments this year. You know, they were all grass lakes, and I knew I wasn't like the greatest at grass, because we don't have grass out in Arizona, really, not that much. You know, what grass we do, it's not like the grass in Florida. And I didn't realize how not good I am at grass. So we've got our next tournament. I leave day after tomorrow for Grand Lake in Oklahoma, and I've been there before. Mm-hmm. And fished there. I liked it, and there's no grass there. And so, you know, I get to hit some stuff that I think I'm better at, and I get some new stuff. But that's why I went. I mean, that's why I went. I wanted to go new water. I love Lake Pleasant here by my house, but I don't want to fish Lake Pleasant all the time.
No, I totally get that. And I think that, like when we're talking about Lake Mead, or we're talking about, you know, something like that, or I'm sure Havasu with the grass and stuff like that. And it was eye opening just going to the Delta and fishing the grass that they have at the Delta. And when you're listening to people talk about ripping a trap or ripping a, you know, crankbait through the grass, and like what that's actually like when you're fishing different kinds of grass than what we have in those desert lakes or what I have here at home. It's a lot different. And I'm sure, you know, everything that I've heard and talked to people about, Florida's its own deal. And it sounds like, you know, that was a little bit of the case for you as well in these first few ones.
No, it is. And you know, it's different. And I like the Delta. You know, I fished the Delta a number of times, and I really love it up there. But it's weird. You know, Florida, you get on these lakes and it's a big round ball. And you're like, well, it's a big round pond, and these guys know exactly where the bass are going to be in what kind of grass at certain times of year and at what time of day. And it's really interesting. Like, it's interesting to learn about this stuff or whatever. But in the meantime, you know, you're paying a pretty big entry fee.
Right.
But it's interesting to learn about it, you know, and I'm like, I have no clue what grass they're going to be in. Like, I'm fishing tulies when I should be fishing, you know, should be fishing grass over here or hydrilla out in the middle or, you know, whatever. But I'm learning, and it's really neat to kind of reflect back on your tournaments and go, man, you know, if I had that a do-over, I could probably do better. And, you know, and maybe you wouldn't, but you do that a bunch of times and you definitely start to learn.
Well, that's, I think, the major thing that, like, with someone like you on your rookie season on the tour, you know, you got to reflect and you've got to learn, you know, no different than like what I'm trying to do with my pro-ams and stuff like that is, you know, I'm probably fishing a little bit over my head in terms of what I'm doing, and I end up having to pay those dues and learn and all that. And, you know, you just haven't been in Florida. So when you get to something that suits your talents a little bit better, then you might have more success. But even the biggest names in bass fishing, you know, there's guys that struggle there. I've heard Brandon Polinick struggles in Florida and, you know, stuff like that. And he's won AOIs and he's, you know, one of the biggest names in fishing. And it's just one of those things, like, all of us have our strengths and sometimes they don't always line up with where some of these events take place.
Yeah, no, and it's true. But I'll tell you, what's really neat about fishing the tour is just you know, being able to kick around with guys that I'm 48 years old, and you know, I watched Jimmy Houston and Larry Nixon and, you know, the guys when I grew up, and I remember sitting in front of the TV watching them for hours and hours and hours, and I would record it on my VCR, you know, on a beta tape, and now, you sit there and talk with Jimmy Houston because he's standing right next to you, you know, mm-hmm. and so. So it's kind of neat, and you know, if you have that type of opportunity to be able to fish on that level, you wanna enjoy it. You kind of need to suck it all in, and you need to enjoy the daylight while it's there, you know. And I've been enjoying it a lot. You know, I've been traveling with Marty Lawrence, but I've got friends on the tour. You know, Cody Murray and Miles Howe just did really, really good at the tournament Seminole. He had a top 10 finish, you know, and Miles and I are friends. And so it's been a really good experience, and I've still got 4 more tournaments left. So I'm looking forward to all those. I'm glad it's not over.
Yeah. And you said the next one's Grand Lake, right?
Yeah. Grand Lake in Oklahoma. And I fished a Costa there last year. And didn't do bad there last year. I lost the fish. It cost me a check, but that's not the point. Point is when I was on the lake, I felt comfortable. I was in like 20th place after the first day. I caught a good bag the first day, and I just it's kind of up my wheelhouse. It's docks and rocks and wood and I love docks. I like skipping stuff under docks and stuff like that. So I'm looking forward just to fish it. I mean, it's just one of those lakes and there's a lot of fish in Grand Lake. You can catch fish all over that lake. And so, it's one of those lakes where, you know, if you and I were going fishing, that's a lake you'd want to go fishing in.
Yeah. So what are you kind of expecting to do there? Like technique wise, or are you just kind of going fishing and seeing what you find in practice? Or do you kind of have a game plan going into practice?
No, I definitely have a game plan. I think Grand Lake's one of those lakes. It's pretty easy to pattern, and like I said, there's a lot of fish all over that lake. I don't think anybody would tell you any different. You know, a lot of, you know, you'll sometimes go to lakes and you'll feel like there's a lot of dead water, you know, and that's not the way it is with Grand Lake. Like, you could potentially win it out of any cove or any cut, you know, and so, it's really, Grand Lake is kind of, it's generally real clear at certain parts of the lake, and then it's kind of stained in other parts of the lake, and then real dirty on other parts. Well, it's going to be more dirty overall. They've got a lot of rain and things like that, but you do get some clear water coming in the Elk River sometimes. And but I like fishing muddy water. I mean, pea soup's fine with me, and so. It's really a squarebill, crankbait type, spinnerbait, that type of a lake, jigs. It's that type of a lake. You're kind of your normal dock stuff. And there's docks. The whole lake is docks. I mean, it's just docks. If you think Clear Lake's docks, this place is really docks.
Got it.
So I really like it. I'm looking forward to it. I kind of have my, I've got my, juice bucket filled with, spinner baits and jigs and things like that. So, get up there and see what we can do.
Now, since you've fished a few of these, FLW tour events so far, it's been 3 or 4 so far.
Three so far. Sam Rick, and, we had the Kissimmee chain. And then we had Seminole, and Kissimmee Chain and Seminole right next to each other. I mean, it's like a 3.5-hour drive, you know. It's just Florida and Georgia. In fact, Seminole's, you know, it's partially in Florida still.
Now, from what you've seen, like, when you were fishing the Costas or the Wild West or just your regular pro-ams versus when you're fishing on the tour, is there any, like, differences that you can see and, you know, how guys practice or how guys fish? Like, do they cover way more water than the average guy? Or are they just better at timing? Like, what do you think, or what do you feel are some of those things that people just may not, you know, realize without having done all of it?
I think the one thing that kind of stands out to me, and I think it's more not because it's the FLW tour, but just because of where we're fishing. I think one of the things that stands out to me that I've really seen is every single one of these tournaments was won by a guy who basically found a big group of offshore fish and sat on them and never moved his boat for 10 feet the entire tournament. And so these are guys who are, they're experienced. They've been to these lakes 100 times. They kind of know where these offshore fish are going to be. They'll know 7 or 8 hot spots where they're going to go, and they dial these things in. And so, you know, in one sense, that's a hard suit to follow when you don't know the lake. You know, that would be like, you know, winning the lottery to hit that one spot that's 20 foot by 20 foot, you know. So you kind of have to do different things to, you know, I have to do stuff to try to cover more water, you know. Now at Seminole, I did find a real good spot, but I didn't dial them in until the second day. Second day, I dialed them in pretty good, it's just, it's harder to do. I think you see more guys find an offshore, you know, heavy schools offshore. And I don't see that sometimes out here out west. You know, it seems like out west you can cover more water and do well doing that. And so far that hasn't been the case back east. But you only have 3 days to pre-fish on the FLW tour. I know Wild West on their pro-ams, they're just 2 days or whatever. That's probably the one thing that really kicks me hard. I feel like it takes me longer to pre-fish than a lot of guys, you know, like, I don't know, Ty Au, you know, he's like, yeah, you know, you give me a day on the lake, I'm good, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. I'm like, how do you do that, Ty? I'm like, but I'm not good at that, you know, I'm not good at that. And so, you know, I'm like, if I had 5 days someplace, I feel like I can really kind of dial it in. And I think it's because I categorize my pre-fishing more, you know. I kind of got a set, you know, I'm going to do this, this day, I'm going to do that, and I'll get off that or whatever, but I kind of break it up, and I compartmentalize this, you know, more than some guys where they flow a little better than me, I think. So the 3 days pre-fish has been a little different, because like when I fished the Costa back there last year, I pre-fished for 6 days and felt like that was really good for me, you know. So, you know, I like that on one bass, you know, and the Costas, I like that longer pre-fish. But, you know, again, you know, on the FLW tour, these guys fish a ton of big tournaments throughout the year. And, you know, if you gave them even more pre-fish, it's more time away from the family. And so I understand why they do it.
No, that makes sense. Now, are you trying to make any adjustments in how you go about your pre-fish to kind of, since you're identifying some of this, so that way you can, you know, feel like you're giving yourself a better chance in that shorter period of time?
Yeah, like at Seminole, so you know, for the guys that don't know, you know, Lake Seminole, the place is the craziest. And just take that one lake for instance. And I hit a stump out there like 35 miles an hour. Ooh. Or two, and the whole lake is an entire forest that is flooded, and they never cut any trees down. Well, they're all broke off 6 inches under the water. Like, and I'm not kidding you, it's 6 inches under the water. And I'm talking big stumps, you know. I was talking to Josh Bertrand, you know, a long time ago, and I said, yeah, I got to go to Seminole next year. He's like, there's some big stumps out in the middle, you know. I was like, I didn't realize how right he was until I actually saw it. And so... Finally, I had decided that it was wasting my time trying to run around that lake. Like, there are certain parts of the lake where I was like, okay, I have that marked because I checked it out on Google Maps and I want to go over there. But I couldn't get there unless I put my trolling motor down. It's 3/4 of a mile to get there. Yeah. Because you can't drive over there with your boat. You wreck your prop in the first, you know, 200 feet. Mm-hmm. So I decided, you know what, I'm going to stay closer up by the river. I'm going to pick out a couple of spots, and I'm going to work just a very small area. And I think it was much more successful for me. I threw the wrong baits the first day, so I didn't have a good weight the first day. But the second day, I dialed it in, and it was a lot of fish there. And I think I just need to do that more. I think I'm biting off a little bit more. And I think when you've got a limited pre-fish, you've got to limit the water that you cover. And the harder it is to cover that water, you've got to dial it in even smaller and smaller.
Got it. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. That makes a lot of sense. So what are you kind of looking forward to the rest of the season? And like, what to you makes a successful first year on the tour?
you know, I really wanted to make the cup. That's out for me. There's no way I can make the cup or whatever. I just want to cash a few checks on the tour. If I can cash a couple, 2-3 checks on the tour, I would think it's a really successful year for me on the tour. So, and I still have an opportunity to do that, and that's what I'm going to try to do. So there's that. I want to do that really, really bad. I'd like to cash a couple of checks there. Then I can't wait for the U.S. Open. It's a highlight of the year every year. I'd like to fish the one bass at Clear Lake, and I'd like to pick up some Wild West stuff too, but I just can't, I can't do it right now. But my season in the FLW is basically over by July 1st. So I will, at that point, I'll spend a little time fishing around here, doing some stuff around here, and then I'll be getting ready for the U.S. Open after that, and I'm going to take that pretty darn serious this year too.
Yeah, I think a lot of us are going to be out there in October, and I talked to we had a boat show out here, and I talked to Billy Egan about what he's hoping to get numbers wise for the U.S. Open, and he's shooting for 250 this year, and I think that's like the max that he's going to let it go. Even if people want to go further than 250, I think his magic number and his stopping point's 250, and that's a huge field.
Oh yeah, that's a big field, and he'll get it. I mean, if he doesn't get it, it'd be really close. I think he'll get that. I think we did 225 or 224, 227, something like that last year, mm-hmm. and I think he had guys still want in. So, that's an epic tournament. Guys come from all over the country to fish that thing. I mean, Rick Klun, all these guys, and I you look at the guys who won it, and it's the who's who of bass fishing. You
know,
John Murray. So why would you not want to do well on that?
Perch,
you
know? Brett Hyde. Yeah, I mean, you could just go on with the names.
Yeah.
Well, Kevin, I really thank you for taking the time to do this interview. I think there's a lot of good information in here, and just getting to know you better. And I think the different stuff that we covered, I think it's helpful to a lot of the younger guys, especially that are interested in trying to get sponsorships or wanting to go and fish professionally. And I just really think that getting insight from guys that are currently doing it and kind of getting some of the background on how they got there and what they're doing to stay there and what they're just the stories. I think the stories are what's important. And I think that everyone just, finds their favorite pro and just think they just were always there. And there's always a story behind how the guys got there, what's the motivation, all that kind of stuff. So I just want to say thanks for taking the time to talk with me today.
Hey, thanks a lot, Matt. I appreciate you having me, and hope to come back at some point in the future.
Yeah, I'd love to do that. I think that, over time, hopefully, these interviews just get better and better on my behalf, so that way I can make sure that I'm asking the good questions, because I have no experience do this. I'm just kind of winging it and doing the best I can. But I know we talked about McMillan first thing, but are there any other sponsors you want to, have a chance to promote or say some good things about?
I could really thank a whole laundry list, but I'd really, Bass Pro Shops, they just do a great job for me. Nitro Boats, I mean, I'm always in the finest equipment with Nitro Boats. I mean, it's great. I've got my new boat coming. It's got the new Mercury on it. Mercury, Mercury's never let me down. I mean, it's an incredible motor, and I really appreciate those guys down at Mercury so much, and the guys at Nitro Boats. All the people down at Bass Pro Shops, Mesa, Arizona, fantastic people. Trophy Technology, they run BD Baits, Castaic Swim Baits, Katana Hooks. Those guys have been good to me, and I really appreciate them. DJ Custom Jigs, I mean, David Burns is a great guy, and I throw his jigs, throw his chatterbaits, and so, I really appreciate these guys, and those are the types of partnerships that you need when you want to fish the big stuff, and I don't know that I'd be fishing the big stuff without all that stuff, to be honest with you.
No, I understand completely. I mean, just the financial aspect of it, and just getting down to needing jigs and needing hooks and needing baits. Like, it's just the amount you need for an entire season when you're practicing for 3 days and you're fishing for, minimum 2, maximum 4, and, the time in between if you go and pre-practice, all that just adds up. I mean, $5 to $15 crankbait, depending on which one you buy, or even more, like, those add up over time. You know what I mean? You lose hooks, you lose gear, you need different colors. It all just adds up. So I get it.
My boat, it should go, it's a fast boat, should go faster, Matt, but it's loaded down. I mean, I've got so much stuff in it. And it's true. I mean, you end up needing so much stuff. And so having those partnerships sure does help.
Well, awesome. Thanks again for being a part of the interview. And I think it was really good. And I just want to thank everyone for watching. I want to thank Kevin for being on and doing this interview with me. If you enjoyed the video, please make sure you like it, you share it, and you comment. Again, if you haven't subscribed, please subscribe and hit that bell for notifications. And thanks again. And thank you, Kevin.
Thanks a lot, man. Talk to you later.
All right.